My name is Sarvana Prilata, and I'm co-authoring this with Professor Rosemma Idrus. Okay, many of you will be wondering, why am I talking about cyber law? Very simple. The issue is like this. Many of us here are technology practitioners. We are also technology users, and we are also e-learning creators. Unfortunately, we do not know a lot of issues in e-learning or m-learning. For example, I give you just one example. Whenever we create websites, if there are any website designers here, all right, or website programmers, they'll understand what I'm talking about. If let's say you are creating a website and you are linking to another website called www.autobiography.com, do you realize that you must get a written permission from autobiography.com before you link it with them? Before you even think about them, you should write to them personally, black and white, either an email or black and white, fax and sign. If they do not consent to that, you have just done a very, very, you have just given them a good case to be brought into cyber law. Alright? They will just argue with this. You created an illegal link to my website, and my website is now congested with traffic because of you. That's the only reason you might be ending up having a hole in the pocket, because cyber law cases can run up to millions of dollars. They're not 1,000 or 2,000. And even if you go to the arbitrators, alright, you still have to pay for the arbitrators. And there are no Malaysian experts who can do that. There are very few, a handful of them. In Penang, you only have one or two. In Putrajaya, you only have three. That's it. The others, they know cyber law, but they don't dare to fight for you. So be careful. That's all I want to say. We can engage in a serious discussion even after the break, even during the break. Or I can also give you my email address, and if you need any specific questions which requires technical details, I can ask my consultant. First of all, cyber law is an area of law. It deals with the relationship that internet has with technological and electronic elements, including computers, software, hardware, and information systems. Information systems here is defined. Learning management systems is part of the internet. It is also part of information systems, including databases. You will be quite surprised. Computers, software, WhatsApp, it's part of a software. Illegal use of WhatsApp, you can be brought to cyber courts. Okay? Alright. Next. Very important question. When I was writing this, my prof asked me, very simple. Why is it so important? Who cares? I said, no, it's very important. Without knowing it, how do you know that you've just committed a crime? I mean, like, you're driving a car on the road, you've knocked down a cat. Oh, it's just a cat. But don't forget, it's also life. You have just committed crime. And if someone has taken a footage of it and just uploaded it on Facebook, we have done a serious crime. Be careful, alright? It's important because it can produce very large-scale damage from cyber criminals, a lot of them outside, by protecting information access, policy, privacy, communications, IP, intellectual property, freedom of speech related to the use of the internet itself, websites, email, computers, cell phones, the one that you're having with you in your hand, software and hardware such as data storage devices, including your bank drive, external hard drive. We have another one which is called optical disk. Okay. The next one will be higher proportion, because there's an increase in internet traffic, you see, I told you, led to a higher proportion of legal issues, because cyber laws vary by jurisdiction and country. Enforcement is really challenging, and restitution ranges, restitution means punishment, ranges from fines to imprisonment. I haven't told you, right, the hyperlink, how many years we can be in the jail. Depends on the country. If you have just done it in US, you can be inside for a very long time. Okay. Now, the need for cyber law, there are a few. Integrity. Are you sure that you are creating the right system? Are you sure that it's for the good use? Security of information. Now we have a lot of cyber attacks. Now we have a lot of data which are stolen from you. How do you know that you're using the safest system in the world? Okay, I'll give you one clue at coursera.openlearning.com. Now, if they are stealing something for free, why do I have to give my personal information? I don't need to do that. Have you ever asked yourself why they are asking for your personal information? Number two, what's the definition of cookies? It's not biscuits. Cookies are small bots, they're robots, they're internet robots. They search a lot of things in our hard drive without our knowledge while we are surfing. But you allowed it. Remember, there will be a pop-up advertisement or pop-up message every time you go to certain websites. And it'll say, this website uses cookies, without you knowing what is cookies. You say, yeah, I agree. They already put a small font size definition. Click here for the terms. And when you look at the terms, it's about 10 pages. I'm not going to read 10 pages, just to use 2 minutes. The moment you click, the bots will save every information about you. Dr. Meisel told us yesterday, I keep getting phone calls from many people around the world. How did they get my info? Data stolen. You went to insecure site. Even insecure Wi-Fi. The moment you use these Wi-Fis here, without password, the Wi-Fi can be shared by others. A good hacker will hack that Wi-Fi and go straight to your mobile phone and steal your private credit card data. I can actually do that because my Master's of Science was in neural networks, artificial intelligence. I did this in 2001 in USA. And my lecturer was Iyer Nair from IIT, Indian Institute of Technology. You should see the way how he asked me questions in my Viva. I nearly cried. He asked me the meaning of the codings. I never thought he was going to ask me that. Alright, next we'll have security of government data. Well, we know that Malaysian government, secure, I can say secure, but it's not as secure as we think. We don't have good hackers. The good hackers are the best security providers. We really don't have. We always engage them from outside, mainly from India. You'll be quite surprised if I say that we also engage them from countries that we do not have diplomatic relationship with. I refuse to answer the name of the country. I think you can think about it. Alright, next, intellectual IP property rights. Recently, a few students of mine, they created an iBook. They said, sir, we are creating this for mathematics. Sir, we want to create mathematics, please. I said, excellent. But I said, patent it. Patent it. Sent it to a copyright lawyer, patent it. They said, no, sir, it's expensive. I said, take your savings, patent it, before you show it to someone else. Yeah? So now, every now and then, they know how to patent it, so that no one steals it. Okay, that's the reason why we need cyber law. We don't want stealers, we don't want thieves. Privacy and confidential of information, ladies and gentlemen. You still remember the data that I told you? How do you know that every time you use your WhatsApp, no one is stealing your information? Whenever you share your photos in the WhatsApp group, how, this is my house, this is my car. How do you know there is no spy box inside? That's saving every part of your information. You're not sure. How sure are you WhatsApp is safe? My consultant, Dr. D.P. Raja, told me, the reason why the Americans invented internet was only for one reason, to conquer the mindset of Easterners, we. This is just another way of how they can conquer many things in their life. Have you ever asked yourself why Facebook is banned in China? Have you asked yourself why Google is not allowed in China? They have excellent artificial intelligence programming. We only see images on Google, about satellite images, about 10 years ago. But Google can always change it, and within a few minutes they can take photos of their honey. That powerful satellites they have. Mark Zuckerberg, we go to a holiday to Bali. Mark Zuckerberg sends a spaceship. Why do you think he's doing that? He's thinking about what's going to happen 100 years from now. Okay? That's legal status of online transactions. I just want to know, how many of you here do online shopping? How many of you here do online shopping? Lazada? I think all of us. I don't. I don't even have credit card. You'll be quite surprised. I worked in the Canadian High Commission before, but based in Ottawa. My direct boss was the Prime Minister of Canada, John Chrétien. I had a credit card. Then I had a chance to work with the CIA and some top hackers in the world. They told me it's better you don't use credit card in your life. Certain reasons they told me, I'm sorry, I can't share. But I can't change my wife's money. I tried to tell her, don't use it. She says, no, it's the easiest way for me to do shopping. So, ladies and gentlemen, how sure are you Lazada is safe? How sure are you Alibaba is safe? Okay, you are putting your credit card number, am I right? Can I ask you one question? It will transfer, it will pass by Lazada's server before it goes to HSBC or public bank and so forth. It doesn't go directly to public bank. Why Lazada needs your number? Have you ever asked yourself? They are database administrators who can steal 1 cent every day from your account. Do you know that? A popular case that I would like to cite, 1985. Alright, a very famous banker who had pension for fantastic cars stole 5 cents from all the account holders. He was an IT grad. He was a database administrator. That's why database administrators are highly paid around the world, so that they don't steal. So be careful with that. That's the reason we need it. We have Digital Signature Act 1997. If you want to put a digital signature for your Microsoft Word document, you can do it. Alright, you can just have to hold it and you can just insert signature line. You can put a digital signature for every document that you're sending out there. It's very simple. You do digital signatures, and we have this in our country. Identity and verification standard. It uses complex coding, encryption we call it. It's an end-to-end encryption, so that nobody can change the content of the letter once you send it through your email. Let's say I'm sending one email to Mr. Azmi here, my friend in Sabah, and it's confidential information. Do you know that it can be trespassed? Someone can just bypass that document, take it out, change the content and give it back to him. That's why we need digital signature. As teachers, we'll be sending a lot of letters. Parents will be sending a lot of letters. Students will be sending a lot of letters. University will be sending letters. Do you know that in USM, we teach students how to hide? Are you telling me they don't know how to do it? Of course they know how to do it. We have done it. I'm not joking. Give me your phone number. Let's go online now. I can ask the boys in USM to do it. Within 5 minutes, you'll receive a message. You just have done a shopping in Lazada. We have that powerful hackers with us. It's just that we don't misuse them. Okay? Now the next one, it protects email forgery. The encrypted codes have user's name, everything. And by doing this, nobody can eavesdrop, nobody can spy your documents. That's the reason we need digital signature. Finally, we have Computer Crimes Act. This is in our country. Can I ask you a question? What do you mean by computer crime? Can you do a crime in a computer? Can. I can always create a new learning lesson, such as 1 MDB, the fall and the rise. Is that a crime? Yes. Why? The court, the case is still in the court. What does our system say? No one is guilty unless he is proved guilty. Am I right? That's what the legal system of the world sees. Alright? So here we have computer crimes. Computer crimes can be done just like what our first presenter, Spino, said. Alright? In the digital world, there are a lot of fake information going on. Why? They use computers to spread lies. The government doesn't need Fake News Act. They can use this act, bring us to the court, they will win 100% because it's already enacted. It's gazetted. Okay? So be careful whenever you say something about someone on Facebook, you can be sued in this act. And there are a lot of students also do crime on computers. For example, they steal someone's assignments. Did they do that in their notebook? Yes. Did they do that in their computers? Yes. Is that a crime? 100%. End of the day, 0 months. But they won't let you go. They will never let you go. They will bring you to the court. And they will prove it that it's a cyber law. In our country, there's always a first in everything. There's always a first in everything. In every state, there's always a first. And they will always take it and show to the whole world, hey, we have done the first thing. We have given the first punishment. I guess you all know what I'm talking about. But when a student does this accidentally, he's also committing computer crimes. Now, if it's the student, he can do that, our teachers. Accidentally, we can do it, but can you go and tell the judge, I'm sorry, it was just accidental. He will say, a crime is still a crime. Be careful. These are the acts which you have. Alright? Next. Telemedicine Act is more towards doctors, students who are doing medicine program. They can only send emails to their patients, they can send emails to another doctor, it's encrypted. You have to understand that people love to kill other things. I mean, people love to kill, they're murderers. They can always intercept your emails, they can open, change the prescription of drugs. Once they change the prescription of drugs, it's there. You get wrong drugs. This has happened in India before. A lot of students in India are very good hackers because they're trained by the best Israeli hackers. So what they did was, they don't like their teacher is a doctor. They're doing medicine program. They intercepted his email, changed the name of the drugs, and when he gave the drugs to the patients, many died. The teacher was arrested. But it's impossible for a doctor who has a PhD to do that. FRCS, MRCS, he has completed. After deep, thorough investigation, they found that the students were the ones who did it. Smart students, isn't it? We teach them to be smart, they become criminals. We have Communications and Multimedia Act. This is what all BTP staff should know, and I think you know about it. It ensures information is secure, network safe, reliable, services affordable all over Malaysia. I just want to do a small competition. Maybe we should ask some hackers to hack our form reality. What do you think? I give you a few examples. I guess that in 15 minutes, 5 hackers, we can change the system. We can paralyze it. I give you one example. The parents' online grading system, you still remember? Do you know why it was done? Parents will check students' online results. Do you still remember? Do you know it was hacked? MCMC said there's nothing wrong with the system. But the server was hacked by students. They are not satisfied with the marks given by the teachers. And all of them are Form 1 and Form 2. Has it ever come out in the newspaper? Impossible, but I'm very proud. Do you know why? They are trying to go against the system. We have finally created the best network security programmers in the country. We should be proud, isn't it? Our education system allows them to do that. Okay? So be careful. Artificial intelligence in classrooms, does it help students to cheat? I ask you a question, does it help you to learn? Yes, if it helps you to learn, of course it helps you to cheat. What is artificial intelligence? Make things smarter in our life, like the phone that you have next to you. The phone that you have with you is extremely smart. It wakes you up at 6 o'clock. It tells you the ways, turn left, turn right. 15 years ago, the phones couldn't do that, but now it can do that. That's an example of artificial intelligence. That's a very small example of artificial intelligence. That's why, till now, no American president is allowed to use Apple phones or smart gadgets, because there is already a GPS tracker in that phone. It can be used for good, it can be used for bad. So if you use our AI in classrooms, this will happen. We have robot lawyers, robotic lawyers. Yes, you can just put the case file and the robot will tell you what to do, what to argue. We have robotic waiters in Kuala Lumpur, so we have, Japan we have. We have robotic front desk girls in Japan. So robotic teachers just not miles away, meters away. They're very near. It will happen, you just have to wait and see. Unfortunately, there are problems with them. They can be manipulated. They can be changed. Marks can run away. When students cheat, the robot may not see. It cannot feel. They are human androids, but they cannot feel. Okay? This is 21st century classroom. If you look at the diagrams, I hope it's a bit big. We have many elements in the 21st century classroom. We have Wi-Fi, we have laptops, we have iPads, we have mobile phones, we have everything. How do you know they are not cheating? How do you know they're not posting your pictures online and telling that you are not a good teacher? Have they committed a crime? Yes, they have. How do you know that they have just copied the question paper and sent it through WhatsApp and asked for answers from around the world? Do you know that? You will never know that. But we are talking about 21st century classroom. Have you ever asked a children, do you like 21st century? You go and ask your students. I ask them every day. You know what they hate about 21st century? They hate keeping together. I don't know who created that. Why they have to sit together? They can sit under the tree. That's the function of 21st century classroom. We don't need a classroom for 21st century. We are moving to a 22nd century. Am I right? Yet, we have to understand, mobile gadgets are not gadgets. They are not toys, but they are spyware. They are programmed in such a way. They are programmed to be smart in their life. But I don't know, how do you make them smarter? I want to quote a famous leader that's close to my heart, the late Nick Aziz. There was an issue of legalizing sex education in the country, and the spiritual leader that I'm very close, because I ate in his house before, so I know. He asked one question to everyone, till now no one could answer. By teaching sex education, you're teaching the robbers how to steal. I hope you understand what I'm saying. By teaching them coding now, by teaching them programming now, don't you think that, if they can use it to good use, I'm happy. How if they don't? How if they start hacking? How if they start posting things which we don't want them to do? Tribal law comes in. Now, you have to remember, of course, we can only bring them to court when they are 18 years and above, because at that time they are adults. Unfortunately, in our country, only 21 above can vote, but 18 years are already adults. Okay? But university students can be brought to the court. It's very easy for them to cheat. There are a lot of gadgets you can use. We have glasses with spyware. We have smart watches that people can talk, you can just listen. A lot of cheating cases, just like what Ibrahim said just now. Okay? This is what most of them do. This is how students use technology to cheat in online exams. In online exams, there are nobody around them. There's no one around them. They are alone. How do you know they are cheating? How do you know they are in discussion? OUM representative. How do you know it's not Ali, but it's Fatima online? How do you know she's giving the right answer? You don't have a proper technology to authenticate the person. Challenges faced by e-learning developers, LMS developers, anyone here. First, you should develop a good learning management system that does not condone to cheating. We have many LMS, but for me, my personal opinion is everything helps them to cheat. How do I know it's you? How do I know it's you are the one who are answering that question? Without knowing, I just simply give marks. It's another form of plagiarism. Cyber law comes in at that time. Protecting their students' data from breach. They need 18 medical seats allocation. 250,000 data has been stolen. Correction, not stolen, sold by that particular institution to whoever who wants to buy it. Have you ever? I'm sure some of your children have finished their SPM and so forth. Have you ever asked yourself, how come they keep receiving letters, offers, to do a lot of programs and courses, but they never have applied it before? How do they get the data? Breach. Next. We need good firewalls to prevent hacking. Okay, what is the meaning of firewalls? We really don't have good firewalls in Malaysia. That's why even our parliament website has been hacked. Okay, let's put it aside. Firewalls prevent. It needs proper authentication before you go straight into a certain system. Alright? And many schools can't afford it. I think that they can't afford it. They also don't have expertise to maintain it. My son is studying at AT University. He's going to go to US in 1 year. I saw the way how they do blended learning. It's so superb. Not even a single day the system was down. He owns the online activity, he keeps it on for 24 hours a day. So I asked him why. He said, the longer I am, I get more marks. I said, don't you think this is cheating? No, this is not cheating. The longer I am, I get marks. But they have voice over and video discussions, not words. People don't type for discussions. They have face to face. They can see. It's an open webinar where it's not one to many, but it's many to many. Now what we have now is one to many. How do we know that your boy is doing his assignment? How do you know he's not cheating? Are we creating more cheaters in our system? Next. We need good system to check plagiarism activities. It is in place, but students know AI too. We have turnitin.com, blah, 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 blah. Can I ask you a question? I already told you. We teach them programming of AI. Don't you think they don't know how to hack it also? Of course, you can say, if like that, Sarah, we cannot teach. Because we keep teaching that AI. I know, but there's something else we need to teach. That's what we call digital citizenship, which we don't have. DTP should take heed of it. Facial recognition software, we don't have in any LMS software. We don't have. Alright? Quality, you also a principal. I'm sure you have Frog VLE. How do you know that Frog is actually used carefully? How do you know that it's not used by their moms? The mom can have a PhD in history. She can even tell the date when Parameswara came. How do you know she's not teaching cheating? Next. Protect students' online payment data. Can your LMS do that? In your learning management system, can they make payments? Maybe they need to buy something? Can fraud can be improved? These are things I have. Awareness of digital citizenship. Extremely important in our life. That's the question I asked Mr. Ibrahim just now, Dr. Ibrahim. And he said, yes, they did this. Okay, what is digital citizenship? Simple. You want to use gadgets in classroom? Go ahead. Teach them the responsibility of using the gadgets. Teach them how to use it in a proper manner. Do not waste that gadget. They can simply create a Facebook and they can tarnish your image online. Since they are youngsters, they will be apologized. But how about your image? How about your image? What's the guarantee he won't do it again? Because he knows he's a child, nobody can do anything. He's getting smarter, right? This is lacking in our schools. Not only schools, I think it should be made as a subject in all universities and colleges. Digital citizenship. Please take note of this and tell your Pakara, I say. Alright, let's continue. All good citizens, they will protect private information for themselves. They will never tell who they are. Number two, they will stay safe online. They will never do wrong things. They will balance the time that they spend online and using media, just like today's theme. Plug and unplug. They know when to unplug, go outside and play football. They know when to plug and get information for themselves and for their assignments. Next, respect themselves and others. Students nowadays don't respect others. I don't know whether they respect themselves. They like to write everything about their friend. Even their mothers thank them, today my mother spanked me. Is there any law to sue them? Because my daughter will do that. Because her dream is to become a criminal lawyer, just like her uncle. So, how to change them? Digital citizenship. Okay? Next, they need to stand up to cyberbullying. It's a very common thing among children. They can even bully us. Alright? See what's happening. They can respect copyright and intellectual property. They carefully manage their digital footprint. That is a gentleman. Children must be taught not to steal from internet, plagiarism. They should be taught, this is not their work. They have to come up with their own work. That's the only way we can create a creative society with creative learners so that we can have a K economy. But we having a K economy, no, I think we have an F economy, which is a failing economy. Why? They are only users of the technology. They are not creators of the technology. Who created this? The Americans. Who is using it? The Asians. So we are actually begging them. If they are digital citizen users, they will stop using this. When I am in school, I'll use my personal device for educational purposes only. And then he will say, no, alright, I'll listen to my gut. I make sure I'm safe and use appropriate things when I'm online. I'll stand up and say no to cyberbullying. I'll listen to my heart, respect myself and others. I'll listen to my head, I'll protect my private info. Many of them don't know that they must protect their private information. This is part of cyber law, digital citizenship. This should be promoted by you to all the schools. We have digital library, we have digital that. Why don't you teach them being responsible? In that way, this will be a success. Okay? This is what happened in India, mid-2018. Cybersecurity in England. Don't forget, students can always hack into the system and change everything. As I said to you, the system where we look into the grades of all our children. It was actually done by children. There's nothing wrong with the system. Okay? In India, 250,000 students' data sold. This is the data for the entry into medical schools in India, NEET 2018. You can Google it and find out. Data was sold by colleges and universities to others. You put 500 rupees or so, you can get millions already. Okay? So, we need a very good cyber security. All the way, you think the government is spying on you? Can anybody answer that question? Who agrees? Raise your hand. Any government in the world, let's be very general. Please, let's be very general. Any government in the world. Can you raise your hand? When we were extended one, the teacher said, Chepa Tao in the airport. Before the teacher came out, everybody will raise their hand. After we grow older, it's difficult to raise their hand. Don't know why. I really don't know why. I always ask my students, who is coming for school tomorrow? That's a finger. That's a pen for the finger, you know what? Okay, I'll answer that for you. You don't have to answer that. Guys, the moment you are online, you are being smart. I already told you, we have bots. Facebook, WeChat, WhatsApp, Instagram, Telegram, Whiteboard, Noteboard, whatever board, including Floorboard. We have many foundations, but always ask yourself a question. Whenever I want to use their system, why do they need my email address? Why do they want my personal information? Ask yourself. The moment they ask, leave that page. Alright? And I don't know how you use search engines. I don't use Google. I use Meta Crawlers. Alright? Don't use Google, because Google is full of spy bots. You can go to www.metacrawlers.com. Okay, what Google does is, it only search among Google. You know why? That's all they have. If you use Yahoo, it only searches in the Yahoo database. If you use Baidu, it's only Baidu. There's another one, funny name, DuckDuckGo. You know? If you use DuckDuckGo, it only uses DuckDuckGo. I'm not joking, it's you can type DuckDuckGo. But if you use Meta Crawlers, it will search in all the search engines and it's super fast. You see, I just did a digital citizenship class for free. Alright, being more responsible, am I right? Okay, a lot of us, we read, reading your cloud storage, the moment you use cloud storage, you're being spotted. Alright, when you're reading emails, you are. When you're recording all your photos with GPS metadata, and then you send it in WhatsApp or whatever, it is being monitored. Listening to you through lampposts, another software. Tracking your medical history. Profiling your online purchases. Tracking your profiling this and profiling that. I'm sure you still remember Cambridge Analytica. That word, does it ring a bell? Cambridge Analytica? Does it ring a bell? GE13, alright, it was used by certain people to get data. How do they get data? How do they profile you? Profiling people online is very important. In fact, the first step when we create learning management system is we need to profile our students. How do you know what to create for whom? My content may not be suitable for you. That's for profiling our learners. So they need to profile you and data are available. Where do they keep them? Storage room as big as this. They have boxes equals to 1 trillion megabytes or 1 trillion data megabytes. You know? They can simply sell one for US $100,000. So I think I'm teaching you how to win the next election. We can profile them. We can profile easily. Alright? Okay. Next. This is what people in China did. It's also done by students. You see, in China, it's so strict. They don't allow them to use Google and so forth. They also don't allow government to watch TVs, Netflix is not available. They have Weibo, Weibo in Mandarin, but it's based in Shanghai, but it's run by the military. So everything that you say is recorded. The people don't mind. Okay? But this one, this is what they do. They use their laptops or computers. They request viewable to sensors. It's just another way for them to penetrate. They have encrypted requests. They use Amazon CloudFront or Microsoft Azure, Veritone. Okay, these are the softwares you can use to penetrate into firewalls. And finally, they can watch banned websites outside China. So easy. Don't do it in China. I don't want to be responsible. You don't have to do it in our country. If you want, you can do it. It's up to you. Okay? The most dangerous mobile phone is iPhone. No matter how good the technology is, it's created by humans, for humans, and not by robots for humans. So we need to improve our weakness before blaming the technology that we have created to solve our problems. We created this technology, am I right? That means we have a solution for every problem that we have created. But everyone always blames the technology for things that we have created. Cyber law is a dangerous element of law. You can be sued even for the slightest mistake you make online. That's all I want to say. And in the future, of course, I agree with one of the questions asked. What do you think about the fake news? They don't need it. I already showed you, right? They can put you into any of that particular digital private data bill, everything. They can actually sue you in all the 7 cyber laws. You qualify, we qualify to be sued in all the 7. We don't need fake news law. Because they're using everything for online purposes, right? That's why even WhatsApp group administrators, you are more responsible for everything that you do in WhatsApp. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much.